What's good, family? This is Pastor. This is a midweek moment. We're at the midpoint of our week, at the midday point of our day. And so I just wanted to come and say hello to you. Thank you for joining us. If you're joining us in this moment, I want to thank God for another day. Thank God for this opportunity. Coming fresh out of Sunday, getting ready for another Sunday. And y'all listen, as a preacher, Sundays run seriously like going into one, going into the other, going from one to the other. This is real work. And of course, because we're doing things differently in this new space, it comes quicker than usual. So I want to thank God, but I'm still basking in Sunday's worship. We were blessed to be able to have a hybrid worship where we gave virtual worship to those who worship with us virtually. And we also had a park and praise service here on campus. It was wonderful. I want to thank those who came to be a part of that service on campus, as well as those who joined us virtually in our virtual sanctuary. Talked about Sunday, love is for grown-ups, and I'm still vibing off that, still meditating off that, letting it continue to feed my soul as we continue to recognize that abiding in Christ, being connected to Christ, means that we allow for God to do the work in us that only God can do. And the work that God is doing through us gives us space to have perspective that's bigger than ours, that God's perspective is greater than my perspective. I shared Sunday that one of my favorite sermons from Dr. Gardner Taylor's preaching ministry, and for those who don't know Dr. Gardner Taylor, for me was and is the icon of preaching, because he spoke to the human experience. He spoke to the human condition. He took that which was cosmic and brought it and connected it to the human condition. He brought the spiritual and the human together in a beautiful synthesis. And he had a sermon entitled Seeing Our Hurts with God's Eyes. And he uses the John 15 discourse that Jesus gives to deal with what it means to see life from God's perspective. That yes, if you're not productive and there are branches that are not productive, gotta go. But those branches that are productive, God says you gotta grow. And y'all, growing is painful. That's why love is a part of the growth process. And love is the perspective through which we see our lives in growth mode. That's why love is for grown-ups. That's why you have to look at it from that standpoint. As you grow, there are things that you once knew or you once said or you once thought that are not a part of your thinking or your thought life anymore, because you've grown beyond that point. That's what I've been thinking about as we move into this coming week. Because there's some folk who need to be reminded. And you know who you are. You need to be reminded. You're God's chosen. You're God's choice. If you can hear this, and if you can see me, then know God has chosen you. You are God's choice. Don't let anybody convince you otherwise. Don't let your failures convince you otherwise. Don't let people convince you otherwise. Don't let your pain, your past, your predicaments convince you otherwise. You are God's choice. God has chosen you. God has picked you out. And I know life picks on us, but I celebrate the fact that I've been picked out. I don't care what life does to pick on me. The fact that I've been picked out by providence gives me a shout. I feel like shouting right now. Come on, shout with me. That you've been selected. You're God's choice. God chose you. And in choosing God, all you did is choose the God who has already chosen you. That's great news. I want to push that further on Sunday morning. I've been pushing it during morning manna, that you're God's choice. So no matter what life challenges you with, no matter what life challenges you have, remember, you're love's choice. And love's choice is always greater than life's challenge. Come on, tune in with me Sunday. You'll hear more about it. And you'll hear a word, I believe, that's going to bless your life. Listen, we're getting ready for Sunday. It's Mother's Day, so I am excited about celebrating womanhood, motherhood, celebrating the women in my life that have shaped my life. My mama, yeah, my mother, or my grand and my grandmother, but I call her Ma, and I call my grandma, Grandma. So, and I thank God she rests with Jesus, with the ancestors. But I thank God Mama's still alive, Mama's still kicking. Hey, Ma. And I thank and praise God for my wife and what she means to me and what she means to our son, Caleb. As we ponder about where we're going, and members of Trinity, you know by now that we have a three-phased plan here at Trinity. And that three-phased plan came from two sources. It came from our Book of Discipline, the general rules. And those general rules have been synthesized into a neat little book that I've been using during my ministry. I gave it to the class leaders a couple of years ago. Each class leader received this little book from me. So those new class leaders, if you've not received this, just reach out to me. I'll get it to you. It's a beautiful little book. It's an adaptation. It's a summary of the general rules that we function by here in the Methodist Church, particularly the AME Zion Church. Three simple rules. This was written by Bishop Reuben Job. He's gone upstairs now. He's gone to be with the Lord. But he wrote this little book, Three Simple Rules. He condenses the general rules of a Methodist believer, a Wesleyan believer. He synthesizes them into three simple rules. Do no harm, do good, stay in love with God. He says the general rules, when you get past all the language, all the do's and do nots, all the things that we joke about that you shouldn't do, and those things that were written hundreds of years ago that we joke about, like you can't go to circuses and go to movies and you can't read certain books. Reuben Job synthesizes that, and he says, here are the rules. Do no harm. Do good. Stay in love with God. Here at Trinity, we've adapted and adopted these rules as our three-phase plan for relaunching and for some regathering as the congregation. And we agreed that phase three, which is where we are now, would be stay in love with God. Phase two would be do good. And phase one would be do no harm. And of course, when we got to phase one, that means we would be open doing ministry the way we have done some of the things we used to do in terms of our worship and missional activities and the like, that we would be open to do those activities in a way that we would not endanger the lives of people. Now, we've agreed here at Trinity, we are in phase three. And we're staying in love with God. And that's important because I believe that when we are in love with God, we do what we do, not because somebody asks, not because we're trying to be seen, not because we want a reward or a shout out on social media, but we do what we do because we're in love with Him. To be in love with God means that you're all in, listen, and you're going all the way. You're going all out because you know that love is the reason why you live. And we're alive because of God loves us more than we could ever imagine. So Trinity, I guess what I'm saying is this. We're in phase three. Let's stay in love with God. Let's stay connected to God. Let's read God's word. Let's practice spiritual disciplines that will cultivate our lives. Don't be so hard on yourself. Don't beat up on yourself. Love God. And you can love God because the Bible says He first loved us. God first loved us. So God made the first move. And our love for God is the response to God's love for us. That's vertical. Then horizontally, that love is translated and transferred to members of the human community. So let's keep that in mind. Let's keep love central to what we do, Trinity. Let's keep love essential to how we do ministry here in this new space. And we'll be in touch with you. We're moving. We're talking. We're having robust discussions. We're having meetings, preparing for the next phase. I'm not telling you when. I can't tell you when. We're watching all of the informational networks that give us guidance as to how to move. And so we're not politicizing this. We're not trying to be in competition with anybody. But what I want to say to you is that as God leads us, we're going to move and we're going to follow. We're in phase 3 right now, and we're going to stay there probably during the greater part of the summer, and we'll probably move to phase 2 in a few months. I just want to let you know we're doing it in a way that is beneficial to all and continues to keep us all safe. Amen. Amen. God bless you again. Look forward to worshiping with you on Sunday. Excited about what's going on here. Our women are doing some incredible things. Thank my wife and the women's ministry for their preparations. Listen, Trinity, as I close, and this is for Trinity, get in where you fit in. If there's something we're not doing here that we can do, here's how it works. If you suggest it, be a part of working it. You can't critique what you're not joining in creating. Too many people are critical. We don't need critics. We need creators. We're most like God when we create, not when we critique. So come on, let's get together. Let's do some things together. Yeah, we want to do some things this summer, and I pray that we're able to do them. And we can do them if we work together and be the unit and the people that God wants us to be. I love you all. Stay safe, stay peaceful, stay productive. Wear your mask. Yes, wear your mask. Wash your hands. Practice social distancing. Keep your spaces clean and clear. If you can, test the air. Make sure there's no pathogens in the air. Nothing that could cause sickness or virus in the air. We do that on a regular basis here at Trinity Church. And we're so excited that we have members of our church who are in that business. I'll talk more about that in the weeks to come. But we test the air quality here to make sure that it is a healthy space, both to work in and also to do the work that we do in preparation for worship. Take care of yourselves. I love you. Peace.